Good morning. Good morning, Dr. Doshi. I hope you are able to hear me clearly.
Yeah, you can speak. Hello.
Yes, Doshi sir, we can hear you clearly.
Can you hear me?
Yes, very well. We can hear you very well, sir.
Okay.
Thank you very much for joining us. We will just start by a brief introduction, although I don't know if anyone needs that introduction, because Professor Doshi is not only a renowned personality in India but across the globe. But sir, because there are people who are also joining us via Zoom, we are doing this in a hybrid mode. So kuch log hamare samne hai और कुछ काफी सारे लोग ऑनलाइन हैं, उनके लिए मैं आपका इंट्रोडक्शन आई जस्ट रीड दैट. डॉक्टर बालकृष्ण दोषी इज अ फेलो ऑफ द रॉयल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ ब्रिटिश आर्किटेक्ट एंड अ फेलो ऑफ द इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ आर्किटेक्ट्स. आफ्टर इनिशियल स्टडी एट द जेजे स्कूल ऑफ आर्किटेक्चर बॉम्बे, ही वर्कड फॉर 4 इयर्स द कॉर्बूजियर एज अ सीनियर डिजाइनर इन पेरिस एंड 4 मोर इयर्स इन इंडिया टू सुपरवाइज हिज प्रोजेक्ट्स in Ahmedabad. His office, Vastu Shilp Environmental Design, was established in 1955. Apart from his international fame as an architect, Dr. Doshi is as an educator and institution builder. He has been the first founder director of School of Architecture and School of Planning, Ahmedabad. Dr. Doshi has been instrumental in establishing the national and internationally known research institute Vastu Shilp Foundation for studies and research in environmental design. As an academician, Dr. Doshi has been in the US, Europe since 1958 and has held important chairs at American universities. In recognition of his distinguished contribution as a professional and as an academician, Dr. Doshi has received several international and national awards, including Aga Khan Award for Architecture 1993, the Pritzker Architecture Prize in 2018, and our own the Padma Bhushan National Award by Government of India in 2020, and an honorary membership in the American Academy of Arts and Letters in 2021. Dr. Doshi is foremost among the modern architects and has, to his credit, outstanding projects ranging from dozens of townships and several educational campuses, including those for SEP University Ahmedabad, NIFT New Delhi, and IIM Bangalore. His distinguished professional career is more than matched by his academic achievements as the first founder director of the School of Architecture Ahmedabad, started in 1962, which is regarded as both the pioneer and the fountainhead of in India. Now, it very quickly shows that Dr. Doshi's experience and his knowledge in the field was way beyond, probably not even born. So, perhaps it was useful to know a little bit more for people who have not come across his works. Although several generations of architects and professionals and educators look up to Professor Doshi for his inspiration, it is my great honor, sir, today on behalf of ICOMOS India to welcome you at this symposium. And you have taken time out from your very busy schedule. We do hope आपके साथ हमको कुछ बात करने का मौका मिलेगा, कुछ ideas आपके साथ share करेंगे, कुछ आपका जो इतना experience है उसको अपने members के साथ share करेंगे. So thank you very much for joining us, Dr. Doshi.
Thank you.
Dr. Doshi.
बात करूँ?
हाँ जी सर, आप बोलिए सर, please. Yes.
Okay, thank you. It's a great pleasure to attend this conference symposium. It's very relevant and significant. We are talking about climate change, we are talking about physical change, biological change, economic change. So yeah, as such, you know, we are going through tremendous transformation. And therefore, it is very relevant form in which we want to live and celebrate our life. One of the most important things is, what is the build form and what is it that we must live like? What kind of condition do we wear? We live, we work, we transact. There are tremendous contradictions within us in India, because in the last 30, 40 years, India has changed immensely, economically, socially, culturally, and even conceptually. Transportation, lifestyle, education, exposure to global activities, and most important, our cross-national communications. We live in many worlds. Every evening we watch the television and see how the world is going around. So we see beautiful landscapes. We see landscapes, you know, which are unbelievable, whether it is in China or whether it is in Africa or whether it is in far island places. And I think when we see those landscapes, we get transformed, we get wondered, because two, three things have happened. One is, landscape doesn't mean only the earth or the trees or the green places. It's also the connections, you know, foliage, culture. So if we really look at those things on the screen and admire them, and then just reflect on what is happening to us in India, I think we feel rather shocked. First of all, we have to talk about ecology. Earth, the sacredness of foliage, the affluence, the cleanliness, the kind of joyous areas of the lakes and water bodies, and all those there, and we look at us in how come our landscape is really as full as what we see outside? How come our things are depleting? How come we are getting denuded and we are bombarded with highways without any trees, without any gardens? How come our landscapes, you know, of urban places is getting crowded and our transportation network gets congested and we don't have any place to even play? And I think this is something which we have to look at, because our life is supposed to be connected to not only built form, but also tied up integrally with our activities of life and lifestyle. So this topic which we have today is very, very significant, because how does one really talk about the landscape and the cultures that are there? When I came to India in 55, the conditions were very different. I'll just give you some examples. There were a lot of old cities. Old city of Ahmedabad, where I landed. And when I traveled into the desert areas of Jaisalmer, Rajasthan and other places, I saw the cities like Jaisalmer. And then I immediately traveled to Bombay, Mumbai, and I was surprised. Two things. As an architect, I was impressed by the architecture of Jaisalmer, because of the not only the fineness of the place, but the lifestyle of people, the way people lived, the people dressed, the people believed, and the kind of quality that created over centuries. to that in Bombay, when you come Mumbai or any place or Delhi or other big cities, I did not see the same joy. I did not see the same place, same life, same kind of thing. For example, what happens to the evenings? What happens to the sunlight? What happens to shadows? What happens to cross ventilation? What happens to our lifestyles of sitting outside in clusters? What happens to our relation between people and place and landscape and nature? And I think the question that comes up is, and I think it's very, very relevant for us to think about the built form and lifestyle. What kind of built form do we have? When we live, you know, here, and when you live somewhere else, I think the important thing is there is a complete close relationship. And to show it to the students of architecture, I took them to Jaisalmer, because I said that here is a dry climate, here is a city in desert, but yet it is comfortable. It takes care of ventilation, it takes care of shadows, it takes care of the small places, and I could walk around the city. That was not possible anywhere. So, two things I want to talk about. One is, are we really talking about the lifestyles, economies, ecology, and our relationship to that? And I think this is very important.
I think they also prepared some questions.
But I think,
okay.
So maybe what we can do is, if there is any dialogue or discussion, perhaps we can ask a question that what is it that we would like to do in India based on the symposium that we are attending today? And maybe that is how we can start.
Yes, sir. So we would like to hear from you based on your vast experience and engagement, because I'm sure when you started work, when you traveled, when you were designing, when you were thinking, when you were imagining these mega scale townships and even smaller projects, you've always dealt with the idea of, you've always referred to elements of nature. There have been references to myths, there have been references to legends, folklore. Your designs inspire a lot of rootedness into wherever they exist, in therefore the idea of cultural landscape. So we would like to hear from you, sir, if there is a way to articulate that for our participants and for the organizations to
think about. I can probably give you a practical example. Ahmedabad is a city which is very, very ingenious in many ways. Businessmen, economy, ecology, cost, efficiency, comfort, all these things, you know, people from Ahmedabad, those who were my clients, they had traveled everywhere. At one taste of everything. So when they were talking about the house, they said, can the architecture can be comfortable, and do I have save energies, or should I have to put air conditioning? I don't want it air conditioning. So the issue was, if it is a hot and dry climate, what do you do? They would give examples of their traditional buildings, you know, and that is why I was impressed by Jaisalmer. Shadows, creating shadows on the road so that the breeze can go and people can sit in the shadow. Verandas, courtyard to the house, terraces to sleep, you know, in the evening at night so that one doesn't need fans, etc. So one was, how does one work with the climate without using any external appurtenance? minimum air conditioning, cool temperature, lot of cross ventilation, creating, and always gave examples of their old cities. They said, we have a veranda, our streets are narrow, we have an open place, we have projections, and we have all the insulation because the sun and the climate that was there, it created a sort of a breeze direction. So first lesson was work with climate, but use least mechanical devices and give us comfort conditions. Second was, when the climate is like this, whether it is in Bombay or whether in other places, people were thinking, what about the doing business? What about the educational institutions? What about the schools? So they were asking questions about gathering places, open spaces, spaces for people to be in shade. And therefore they were saying, why are we not planting trees which really could give us shade and which give us fertile? So they talked about shade, and they talked about nature. So relationship between the open space, covered space, and closed space. Minimum use of mechanisms. Then they were saying, is it possible that we can transact our business together? So then they said about mohallas. People gathered into the cluster spaces where they could really sit down and do transaction. And if the buildings are oriented in such a way that the sun movement can cast shadows and therefore they can get a comfort situation. So working with climate, working with culture, working with the scales of activities. The other thing that they were saying is, why do we have to all the time go around and create movement so the vehicle travel, like Bombay, you have to travel far distances. Morning till afternoon, so much time goes, you know, into our transport and in the, on the way to the traffic. So is it not possible to really reduce that transport, reduce this mega structure and create several clusters of communities so that our time is reduced in transport, in movement, and we can gather together? So the question that they were asking was, is it possible that our cities can be connected to climate, to culture, to activities based on minimum mechanization, minimum external use? So ecology, most important, we work with climate, work with customs, work with our habits. And I think this is something which can really, you know, a house or building a cluster or a city. And what we taught us, what I practiced therefore was, use local materials, use technologies which are available, which are comfortable to maintain and to create things, use spaces which can create an alternative but additional advantage of climate. You can change, for example, when it rains very heavily, do you really get shadows? Do you get ventilation? Does the air movement take place? And they gave example of Jaisalmer, they gave example of Ahmedabad city, they gave example of cities like Ahmedabad or Pune or other places where our life and our culture was connected. So whether it is a house or whether it is a mohalla or whether it is a small point number of people, the idea is, can we save energy? Can we save time? Can we save ways of working? These are the kind of things, you know, which we should discuss today. How do we save energy? And how do we real way of life where time, energy, tools, and economy are constantly synchronized. And I think that should become the discussion for us.
Sir, many of the points and many of the principles that you mentioned are very clearly ingrained in the design of Vidyadhar Nagar as a township near the historic, let's say, historical townscape of Jaipur. Those images come to my mind as when you were discussing this aspects that need to be brought to the fore. Could you go back a few years and share what was then going on in your design thinking and your discussions with stakeholders, because you were trying to bring together all these aspects in this large townscape that you were designing?
You know, it was it's a very interesting that you are raising or you are bringing the point of Vidyadhar Nagar. I was, when I visited first time Jaipur, and I was so impressed by Maharaja Jai Singh that I could not believe that this Maharaja Jai Singh was talking about the city for their population and saying that how can I give them comfort, employment, how can I give them choices, and how can I give them incentives to create something ideal. So Maharaja Jai Singh must have thought that what is the lifestyle of people. So first thing is, can we give them employment? Second is, if employment is given, will they have to use minimum energy, or do we have to do so? Do you really create for them large distances or compactness? So he created mohallas. Mohallas, you know, in which he created their lifestyle, because those people who came to do the craft, they came from south, they came from north, they came from east, they spoke different languages. So the whole idea was, is it possible that these communities can create several communities related to their lifestyle and save energy, earn money, save time, give them a chance to really talk together and learn something old, and then they create craft, then they create some industry. So the question is, you are talking about 24-hour cycle, you are talking about different thoughts, different skills, different ideas. Whether it is a young child or whether it is the old person, whether he is a teacher, whether he is a businessman, or whether he has come here as transit. So cities are built by people who come from different world. They speak different languages, and therefore, how will they really create communities? So one of the major thing was, he created the communities. And those mohallas connected to different languages, different culture, different skills, and different kind of attitudes to money and employment. So how does one really do that? Do you have a long distance to walk, or can you do this with a group, and can you learn from one from the other? So it is a question of creating networking of things. So a network of lifestyle, skill, and network of creating situation by which you can improve the quality of life, quality of living, and saving energies together, and using local material and local skills. So these things, you know, had to be done. Therefore, institutions have to be built. And those institutions have to be interconnected. Then the question came of, how do we really use local materials use local materials like red sandstone and other stones, but then they also had that how do you really create excitement in the people? So he created styles, he created designs, he created kind of innovations in creating shadows, creating ventilation. Other thing that they found was everybody who lives in any place, it is a question of using 24-hour cycle. Daytime, nighttime, afternoon, the climate changes, which are there, hot sun, cold nights, hot summer nights, ventilation. So where do you sleep? Do you use your terraces? Do you use your verandas? Do you use your courtyard? So saving time, saving energy, saving lifestyle, and creating constantly positive relationships. So that was the other. I learned from Jaipur. The one other thing which I found was that it is not only Jaipur, but it is also in Ahmedabad. And in Ahmedabad city, or even close area centers of Bombay and other places, the ancient area, you find that there are a lot of these things are used. So how does one use local things? How does one start ancient? How does that creating activity? How does one create and enhance culture? I think these issues which we have to talk about, and then we say, who is going to be using them, what kind of things that they will use, and how can we become participants in that use. I think once we start doing it, then planning happens automatically, and it will have its own nuances because characteristics would be particular. And I think this is really how I began. So Jaipur city, and then my new work in other projects came as the same attitude of approach. So this approach I tried, and I have found that this approach has become very useful. You can use technologies which are available to you easily. Economies of scale, economies of time. So distances, how do you really create compact activities? So when you have an educational institution, when you have a cultural institution, or when you have family gatherings, we should be able to know how to use our climate. I think our nights are very cool and comfortable. After sunset, the whole thing changes. Deep night, monsoon, things change. So do we really think in terms of whole cyclic order of climate? Do we find the materials which are suitable to us? Do we find that the technology which is available we can use? So these which I tried to use or question and then invent something for my work. And that is what I had tried to do in the new work that I did.
Thank you, sir. Now, one of the interesting things that is coming back again in your conversation is that nature seems to be working 24/7, and man seems to, you know, in the night time at least, or the different time scales. So things have to be designed keeping in mind that the changes that will happen around us in terms of climate and natural elements, it becomes almost like part of your life cycle. So the built environment, when it interacts with the natural environment, the idea of time and space and the continuum of time and space has to also inform the basis of this design element, of this design thinking. So we were thinking that we were wondering that sometimes you tend to look at cultural landscapes as a scenic or landscape, let's say, as a scenic aspect, aesthetic aspect, which is outside as an external phenomena. And many of our ancient temples and the historical spaces from the past, you even see, particularly in Krishna Leela and the depiction of Mahabharata and many of these texts locally, entire landscapes are depicted in an internal built environment in the temples or big mansions, etc. And stories and legends and myths are told around temple complexes, and social messages are given using those images, which basically in a way says that the idea of culture and landscape is also quite an internalized phenomena as part of our life cycle. Would you like to comment on this aspect? And it is very apparent in your designs as well.
You know, one of the things that I constantly ask is, am I dependent on anything outside my acquaintance? Can I manage the use of whatever I have available to me? So there are families, there are young children, there are educated people, uneducated people, skilled people, unskilled people. Then there is a dry climate, then there are floods, and then there are agricultural lands. So I really try to look at all this together and say, I am not going to depend on anything from outside my region. Second, I would like to really use everybody who is knowledgeable, intelligent human, and use their skill in creating whatever I want. The third thing is that we also have great art. We also have great technology. We have skilled people. We have craft. Fantastic. Then why don't I find those who are available? Can them together in group, whatever we have, we may have something good, something not so good. Then I will not. I learned in Jaisalmer was that everything was available in that desert area, and not only that, but they used that and they heightened the quality, aesthetic quality. So the stone was there, the drought was there, sudden rains were coming together. What they did was, when the rains came suddenly in a totally dry climate, they created very large gargoyles. And I was very surprised that how those large gargoyles were there in a dry climate. But I found that it was not a rain, but it was flooding. So everything became virtue. So can we not make a virtue of whatever is available to us and transform it? That is really what, to me, is sustainability.
There's some internet issue, a little bit. So you'll have to talk a little slowly. You'll have to talk a little slowly because of the internet issue.
Okay.
Some lag.
Yeah.
But I think that's fine. I think they heard the last bit.
Yeah. So what I am thinking about is that this symposium, we should talk about net zero as a mandate. We should use that as a net zero and say that whatever is available to us, yeah. So if it is net zero, then the whole question is, what kind of a land do we have? What kind of a place do we have? What kind of a climate do we have? What kind of temperatures we have? And what are our skills? And I think if we really put those parameters there, and then we say that we will not go and import anything from outside our region. Shadows, trees, gardens, water harvesting, and then using local talent with everybody here. We have so much talent. I mean, the way we use bicycles, the way we use tools that are there. I remember when I came in 55, when I was with Corbusier, there was a woman and a man carrying the material only on that hand cart. And he was quite surprised that this is the vehicle that we found. But what I found was, they were each other helping one another, rejoicing their movement, you know, of labor, and feeling very happy that they are together, working together. So do we really can decide that all the resources which are available to us, whether they are climatic, whether they are human, whether they are technological, whether they are aptitudinal, and can we really not really fuse it together and create, and that is exactly how our cultural artifacts are. That is how you will find in India, in the crafts of ladies, gentlemen, in people, and whatever we call. If you look at Mohenjo-daro, look at the artwork, and look at the craft, look at so our ancient characteristic is available for us to see that we are not less anybody else. We have the culture, we have the talent, we have the economies, and can go ahead provided we decide that we will use all our resources in whatever boundaries we have. I think if we can do that, then we will be able to really enjoy ourselves and do things.
Those were really eye-opening thoughts. And I think the idea of the suggestion, rather, of making virtue of everything that you have around you, and then targeting to achieve net zero as a goal, is indeed an all-embracing philosophy of not only design, but our attitude in everyday life. And you have articulated,
if you look,
one of us to take back as key message from this conversation, where you kind of unearthed or dug up your journey as a philosopher, as a designer, as a thinker, as an educator, as an academician, as a father figure, let's say, of the modern conservation movement in India, and have trained and educated generations of not only architects, but many other people from other disciplines who have, I think, come in contact with you and gained from your knowledge and experience. Whilst we come to the closing part of this session, I've got a question from the floor, and I would not hesitate to say that it is from one of your alumni. And the question is that would you categorize or look at SEPT campus as modern heritage?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Would you categorize or look at the SEPT campus, the SEPT University campus, as modern heritage?
Modern heritage.
Yeah, actually, that was the intent of the school of architecture, and even to students who wanted to go abroad for education. We always think, you know, that world outside is better than our world. So why don't we talk about architecture? What we don't talk about education, what we talk about technology, what we talk about science. SEP campus was doing that. That when we really started, ecology was our subject. Building sciences and technology, we tried to do. That is possible, because what we should really do is, we are not looking at the kind of skills our ancient had, and our school therefore gave emphasis on history, art, music, technology, theater, and sciences. Everybody is available within our campus. Advantages are that during the free time, you could listen to music. It is a spontaneous activity that goes on. So you can create clusters of people, clusters of facilities and gatherings, and then you really rejoice life. It is not separated. Life is holistic. When you drive on the way and suddenly you walk slowly and you hear some good noise, a sound, and we say, what a beautiful music. And you will be surprised, they are not from somewhere else, they are from your backyard. The students can learn instruments, all over instruments. See, it's like a small village. In our villages or small towns, everything is available. And we have rituals. Why don't we look at that as resource? And then we invent. As a result, what will happen is we will rejoice, not only that, but we will learn the idea of sensitivizing ourselves. When we see a good object, if it was done by somebody in our family and we saw it, how it was made, it looks very different from when you buy it from the market. Because your sensitivity of seeing things, of hearing things, tasting it, you know what it means. So what I think is, the symposium must talk about resource awareness, resource mobilization, and resource which creates the work of celebration, work of art, work of life. And it can be really useful. And if you can just go out and look around yourself and make, you will be surprised how much you can enjoy life rather than watching the tea or watching somebody else. When you go to Japan, they had these bonsai trees, small trees in a pot. They are 50-year, 100-year-old trees they cherish. Why can't we do those things also? The garden of paradise can be in your house. So the idea is, Center for Environmental Planning and Technology, that is how the SEP campus is known. We thought the landscape should be with us. Technology should be with us. And this is all participatory. How do we think, you know, why are we not looking that we are skillful? We are competent. We are the guardians. We are the custodians of things around for our seed. I mean, that is what Gandhiji was talking about, self-reliant society. So sustainability, scientific symposium should be self-reliant society. And that is what I think we should really talk about. It's not difficult.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for your kind words and for your for showing us the path and for your blessings that we should be able to walk on this path collectively. We had a very enlightening and learning 45 minutes conversation with you. Thank you so much. This has been an invaluable session for all our participants, and we do assure you that we will take things forward as suggested by you in the conference proceedings, and also the way we will look at the activities of e-commerce in
India. Thank you for this.
From scientific.
I always need to say something.
Sir, you wanted to say something?
No. Thanks a lot for inviting me.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Great.